We praise Allah the way He deserves to be praised. We ask Allah to exalt the mention of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Brothers and sisters, welcome, welcome. It's going to get really, really interesting as we move further into the book, especially because of some of the things I've been coming across in recent times that is making me realize even more how delicate and crucial and profound this topic is. So without any further ado, we will continue with the statement, قَوْلُهُ وَأَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهِ إِقْرَارًا بِهِ وَتَوْحِيدًا. The statement of Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah, I bear witness, I testify that there is no God worthy of worship except Allah alone. He has no partners. And I say so, acknowledging it, and say so in the state of the oneness and uniqueness of Allah. Yani I acknowledge Tawheedan, I am in the state of Tawheed. The Shaykh says, rahimahullah, in the sharh of this, أَشْهَدُ بِمَعْنَى أُقِرُّ بِقَلْبِي نَاطِقًا بِلِسَانِي. The term أَشْهَد, which is translated into English as bearing witness or testify, it means I acknowledge with my heart and I utter with my tongue. I acknowledge with my heart and I utter with my tongue. Can you please mute your laptop? Because I can hear myself. لِأَنَّ الشَّهَادَةَ نُطْقٌ وَإِخْبَارٌ عَمَّا فِي الْقَلْبِ. Because shahada, bearing witness and testimony, is an expression and telling what is in one's heart. فَأَنْتَ عَنْدَ الْقَادِ تَشْهَدُ بِحَقِّ فُلَانْ عَلَى فُلَانْ. When you are in front of a judge, you testify for a person against a person. تَشْهَدُ بِاللِّسَانِ الْمُعَبِّرْ عَمَّا فِي الْقَلْبِ. You use your tongue to testify for one person against the other, but that's actually representing what you have in your heart. وَاخْتِيرَتْ شَهَادَ دُونَ الْإِقْرَارِ لِأَنَّ الشَّهَادَ أَصْلَهَا مِنْ شُهُودِ الشَّيْءِ. Why was the term shahada used and not iqrar? Why don't say أُقِرُّ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ, say أَشْهَدُ. لِأَنَّ الشَّهَادَ أَصْلُهَا مِنْ شُهُودِ الشَّيْءِ. The origin of shahada is from observing and bearing witness to something. أي حضوره ورؤيته, meaning being present and seeing it with your eyes. فكأن هذا المخبر عما في قلبه الناطق بلسانه كأنه يشاهد الأمر بعينه. So the one saying this, it is as though he's able to see it with his own eyes. It's as though he can see it with his own eyes. طيب. لا إله إلا الله أي لا معبود حق إلا الله. وعلى هذا يكون الخبر لا محذوفا وضع جلال بدلا منه. Of course the Shaykh will go into the grammar, and that's not the area we're going to focus on. So I'm going to skip all the grammatical explanation and go into the things that we can actually relate to in some way or another. وَقَوْلُهُ تَوْحِيدًا مَصْدَرْ مُؤَكَّدْ لِقَوْلِ لَا إِلْهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Anyways, it's a form of emphasis and confirmation. Now, نَقُولُ فِي أَشْهَدْ مَا قُلْنَا فِي أَشْهَدِ الْأُولَى. So what we said regarding the first bearing witness and testifying, we will say it again. وَمُحَمَّدٌ, let me make sure I didn't miss anything here. وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكِ, alone with no partners, that all that was explained already. تمام, تمام. محمد هو ابن عبد الله بن عبد المطلب القرشي, أو هو ابن عبد الله بن عبد المطلب القرشي الهاشمي الذي هو من سلالة إسماعيل بن إبراهيم أشرف الناس نسبا عليه الصلاة والسلام. So the Prophet Muhammad is the son of Abdullah, the son of Al-Muttalib, the Qurashi, the Hashimi. He's from the progeny of Ismail, the son of Ibrahim, the most noble of people in descent. The most noble and honorable of people in descent. هذا النبي الكريم هو عبد الله ورسوله. This noble prophet is the slave of Allah and his messenger. وهو أعبد الناس لله. And he is the most devout of all people in his worship to Allah. وأشدهم تحقيقا لعبادته. And he's the strongest regarding that. no one established worship more than him, alayhi salatu wasalam. كَانَ عَلَيْهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ يَقُومُ فِي اللَّيْلِ حَتَّى تَتَوَرَّمَ قَدَمَهُ. He used to stay up at night so long until his feet would swell. وَيُقَالُ لَهُ, it would be said to him, كَيْفَ تَصْنَعُ هَذَا وَقَدْ غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِكَ وَمَا تَأَخَّرَ. How and why do you do this when Allah has already forgiven all of your previous and your future sins? فَيَقُولُ أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. He used to respond and say, should I not be a thankful, appreciative slave? لِأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى أَثْنَى عَلَى الْعَبْدِ الشَّكُورِ حِنَ قَالَ عَنْ نُوحِ إِنَّهُ كَانَ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Allah Azza wa Jal had praised his thankful servant when he said about Nuh, verily he was a thankful servant. And this is in Surah Al-Isra, ayah 3. فَأَرَادَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ أَنْ يَصِلَ إِلَى هَذِي الْغَيْرِ. The Prophet ﷺ wanted to reach that level as well. وَأَنْ يَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى حَقَّ عِبَادَتِهِ. And then he wanted to worship Allah the way Allah deserves to be worshipped. وَلِهَذَا كَانَ أَتْقَى النَّاسِ. That's why he was the most pious of people. وَأَخْشَى النَّاسِ لِلَّهِ. He feared Allah the most among people. وَأَشَدُّهُمْ رَغْبَةً فِي مَا عِنْدِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. And he was the one who was looking forward the most to what Allah Azza wa Jal has. فَهُوَ عَبْدٌ لِلَّهِ. He is a slave of Allah. وَمُقْتَدَى عُبُودِيَّتِهِ أَنَّهُ لَا يَمْلِكُ لِنَفْسِهِ وَلَا لِغَيْرِهِ نَفْعًا وَلَا ضَرًّا. Very important. And the byproduct of his slavery to Allah is that he does not possess for himself. He does not possess for himself or to anyone else any good or any harm. He does not hold for himself or for anyone else any good or any harm. وَنَعْمْ أَيْنَ كُنْتْ أي فَهُوَ عَبْدٌ لِلَّهِ أي وَنَعْمْ وَلَيْسَ لَهُ حَقْ فِي الرُّبُوبِيَّةِ إِطْلَاقًا. And he has no right in the lordship of Allah whatsoever. بَلْ هُوَ عَبْدٌ مُحْتَاجٌ إِلَى اللَّهِ. He is a slave in need of Allah, in the state of poverty to Allah. يَسْأَلُهُ وَيَدْعُوهُ وَيَرْجُوهُ وَيَخَافُهُ. He begs him and he supplicates to him and he asks him, he supplicates to him, he begs him, and he fears him. بل إن الله أمره أن يعلن وأن يبلغ بلاغا خاص بأنه لا يملك شيئا هذه الأمور. Rather, Allah Azza wa Jal commanded him to make this announcement and to proclaim this, that he has no control over any of these things. Allah says in the Quran, قل لا أملك لنفسي نفعا ولا ضرا إلا ما شاء الله. Say, I possess no power or benefit for myself or hurt for myself except what Allah Azza wa Jal wills. وَلَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبَ لَاسْتَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ وَمَا مَسَّنِيَ السُّوءِ. And had I known the unseen, I would have protected myself from abundance. I would have secured for myself an abundance of wealth. I would have secured for myself an abundance of wealth and no evil would have touched me. And we know that the Prophet ﷺ died while he was in a state of poverty. He would go on for days without being able to eat anything, and so on. So he will tie stones around his belly. In one narration, a guest came to him, told him, "I'm very hungry." Prophet ﷺ sent to his wives to see if anyone can host his guest for food. He sent to nine wives. Nine wives replied, saying, "We have nothing but water in our house." So if this is the case of the Prophet ﷺ, then you hear a story, then you will know why the Sufis are the most evil and corrupt and deviant people in this Ummah. Then you will understand those burnt out Sufis and their feeble minds, what they bring. Do you know this one Sufi Sheikh called Ahmad al-Farghali? This Ahmad al-Farghali, among many other Sufis who manage this dunya with Allah. So that's why you see there's a correlation. And there's a lot of commonalities between Shi'ism and Sufism. They all come from the same source of insanity and kufr and shirk. This Ahmad al-Farghali, listen to the crazy stories. And these are written in their books. You can find them in their books. That a man came to him, a Negli. He told him that he was at the beach swimming with his daughter. And then the alligator ate his daughter. So instead of trying to, you know, he put her in his jaws. Instead of trying to save his daughter from him, no. He went to his Sheikh Ahmad al-Farghali. He said, "Ya Sheikh, I was at the beach and the alligator ate my daughter. He said, go back and tell the alligator, come speak to the Farghali, he wants you. MashaAllah, tabarakallah. So this guy goes back to the sea, and there are a lot of people there, and he calls the alligator, he said, ya timsah, come, Farghali wants to speak to you. So the alligator came out of the water in front of everyone, went to Al-Farghali. He told them, spit her out. So he spat her out. Then he called on the ironsmith. He told them, come, I want you to remove all of the teeth of the alligator as a punishment. So they removed them, and then the alligator went back into the water, and khalas. يعني يا شيخ يعني ارحم ابونا الله يرحم ابوك يعني والله يعني over. And this story is 1%, not even 0.01% of the what the Sufis believe, of their mashayikh turning a wooden stick into a maid. His wife complained that she wanted a maid, so instead of renting one and hiring one, he goes to the ghaba, to the forest, and he tells his murid, his student, to get a log, and then he puts on it thawb, huh? Some clothes, and then he started making his little biggie wiggy biggie magic, you know, charumba barumba abracadabra, and then it became a maid. He took her back to his wife. So when these mashayikh claim that, you know, and this guy Farghali, he has a darga in the middle of the masjid, which is celebrated on yearly basis, where people go there and call on him. They say, Al-Madad, Al-Madad, Ya Farghali. Al-Madad, meaning help us, aid us. They call on him besides Allah. They worship him in the house of Allah, in the masjid of Allah. Allah says, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ فَلَا تَبِعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. The masajid belong to Allah. Don't call anyone but Allah. And they have these in the middle of the masajid. Dead people. That, look, he couldn't help you when he was alive. He's going to help you when he's dead. And if the Prophet ﷺ is told to tell you, لا أملك لنفسي نفعا ولا ضرا, then if he does not possess for himself any benefit or hurt, how is he going to be a source of benefit or hurt anyone else? Do you understand why Tawheed is important? Do you understand why we focus on Aqeedah? The Ummah is all over the place. The people are all over the place with their beliefs. In another ayah, Allah says to him, قُلْ لَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ عِنْدِي خَزَائِنُ اللَّهِ وَلَا أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبِ وَلَا أَقُولُ لَكُمْ إِنِّي مَلَكٌ إِنْ أَتَّبِعُ إِلَّا مَا يُوحَى إِلَيْهِ. Say in the Quran, in Surah Al-An'am, ayah 50. Say, I don't say to you that I hold the treasures of Allah. Nor do I claim that I know the unseen. Nor do I say to you that I'm an angel. All that happens is that I receive revelation. All that it is that I receive revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is very straightforward. Or Allah says, قُلْ إِنِّي لَا أَمْلِكُ لَكُمْ ضَرًّا وَلَا رَشَدًا قُلْ إِنِّي لَيُجِيرَنِي مِنَ اللَّهِ قُلْ إِنَّهُ لَيُجِيرَنِي مِنَ اللَّهِ أَحَدٌ وَلَنْ أَجِدَ مِنْ دُونِهِ مُلْتَحَدًا. Say, it is not in my power to cause you harm, nor to bring you to the right path. Say, none can protect me from Allah's punishment. No one can protect me. This is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling you. No one can protect him from his punishment. Nor should I find refuge except in him. يعني إلا بلاغاً, except that it is the deliverance of the truth and the conveyance of the truth. فالحاصل أن محمداً صلوات الله وسلامه عليه عبد لله ومقتدى هذه العبودية أنه لا حق له في شيء من شؤون الربوبية إطلاقاً. So the crux of the matter and the summary is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the slave of Allah, and a byproduct of this servitude is that he has no involvement in the matters of lordship whatsoever. He has no involvement in the matters of lordship whatsoever. And that is very important for us to understand in this day and time, my brothers and sisters in faith. وَإِذَا كَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ رسول الله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه بهذه المثابة فما بالك بمن دونه من عباد الله. As I mentioned, if this is the status of the Prophet ﷺ, then what do you think about those who are lesser than him? فإنهم لا يملكون لأنفسهم نفعا ولا ضرا. They don't even possess for themselves any benefit or any harm. ولا لغيرهم أبدا, let alone to anyone else ever. وبهذا يتبين سفه أولئك القوم الذين يدعون من يدعونهم أولياء من دون الله عز وجل. Then you will see the feeble-minded state of those people that call on their so-called awliya besides Allah. And how many do we have those today? And the state of the sheikh, they commit shirk worse than the Christians and sometimes worse than the Qurayshis. The Quraysh, the kuffar of Quraysh, did not commit shirk at the level that some Muslims, so-called Muslims, commit today in the name of Islam. All of these Sufi mashayikh that enslave the people under them and don't allow them to use their brain, and they just do whatever they tell them, and they think that they benefit them or harm them. Like this Tahir al-Qadri, this clown of the highest quality of clowns is Tahir al-Qadri, where he goes to the grave and he try to speak to the people, or he says that he will come and answer on behalf of people. Yani the statements that they make about the matters of the unseen is insane. Or the Prophet ﷺ coming to him and complaining that there was no ticket back from Pakistan to some country. Ya Sheikh, يعني ارحم أبونا أنت الثاني. لا يعني over يعني والله. وبعدين ولا قبلين. المهم وقوله ورسوله هذا أيضا وصف لا يكون لأحد بعد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. As for the statement and his messenger, a witness that his messenger, this title, this description cannot be attributed to anyone else after the messenger of Allah. So Ghulam, Ahmad Ghulam from the Ahmadiyya, or Elijah Muhammad from the 5%ers in the nation of Islam, and you know, whoever came after the Prophet ﷺ claiming to be a prophet, this one you tell him, go to sleep and don't wake up, Allah and Allah, we're busy. لِأَنَّهُ خَاتَمُ النَّبِيِّينَ, because Prophet ﷺ is the seal of all the prophets. فَهُوَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ الَّذِي بَلَغَ مَكَانًا لَمْ يَبْلُغُهُ أَحَدٌ مِّنَ الْبَشَرِ. He is the messenger of Allah who reached a status that no human being has ever reached. بَلْ وَلَا مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ فِي مَنْ أَعْلَمُ. Not even among the angels as far as we know. اللَّهُمَّ إِلَّا حَمَلَةُ الْعَرْشِ. اللَّهُمَّ, except the carriers of the throne of Allah. وَصَلَ إِلَى مَا فَوْقِ السَّمَاءِ السَّابِعَةِ. Allah, the Prophet, he ascended to above the seventh heaven. وَوَصَلَ إِلَى مَوْضِعِ سَمِعَ فِيهِ صَرِيفُ أَقْلَامِ الْقَضَاءِ. He made it to the point where he heard. He was able to actually hear the scratching of the pens, the scribbling of the pen regarding the decree. الَّذِي يَقْضِي بِهِ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ فِي خَلْقِهِ. The matters that Allah decrees, he heard the scratching of the pen on the paper. ما وصل أحد في من أعلم من هذا المستوى. No human being has ever reached that stage or that place as far as we know. وكلمه الله عز وجل بدون واسطة. And Allah spoke to him without an intermediary. Allah spoke to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم directly. وأرسله إلى الخلق كافة. And he sent him to all of mankind and jinn. Unlike the prophets before him who were sent particularly to their nations. Hey. وأيده بالآيات العظيمة التي لم تكن لأحد من البشر أو رسل قبله. And he aided him with signs that were never given to any prophet or any human being before, any messenger or any human being before. وهو هذا القرآن العظيم. And that ayah, that great sign of Allah, is this great glorious Quran. فإن هذا القرآن لا نظير له في آيات الأنبياء السابقين أبدا. This Quran has no equivalent among all of the miracles that Allah gave the previous prophets. Never, nothing close to it. وَلِهَذَا قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى. That's why Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَيْهِ آيَاتٌ مِّن رَبِّهِ قُلْ إِنَّمَا الْآيَاتُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ وَإِنَّمَا أَنَا نَذِيرٌ مُّبِينٌ. أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ أَنَّا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ يُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ. And they say, why are not signs sent down to him from his Lord? Say, the signs are only with Allah and I am only a plain warner. Is it not sufficient for them that we have sent down to you the book, meaning the Quran, which is recited to them? So when the disbelievers were asking for that, Allah Azza wa Jalla said, it is sufficient for them, the Quran. هَذَا يَكْفِي عَنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. It is more sufficient than everything. And it's from the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jal. Because if Allah were to give the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam miracles that can only be seen by the people during his time, then the people today will say, well, how do we know? For example, if somebody wanted to disbelieve in Jesus right now, If he didn't have Islam to tell him to believe in Jesus, he has no reason to believe in Jesus, because there is no footage of Jesus doing anything that the Christians claim. You understand? Nor did we see Moses split the sea. Nor did we see any of the things that Allah mentioned about them. We believe because Allah told us about them. But if we weren't Muslims, hypothetically, then why would we believe? However, if somebody wanted a miracle of Prophet, it's not related to split in the sea or with giving life to the dead. Even though he had his own set of miracles, والسلام, his miracle has to be eternal after his death. And here we are 1400 years later with the miracle present amongst us in the language of revelation, with the articulation and the eloquence and the diacritical signs and the pronunciation and the recitation and the memorization of hundreds of thousands and millions of Muslims all over the world. A book that is unparalleled. Who can say this about? Yeah, Sheikh, if you watch the Christians debating, they don't even know their own Bible. The Ahmad Didat, rahimahullah, used to have to tell them, this is in your book in John chapter 3, verse 5. And you see the priest go, looking forward in his own book. He doesn't even know his own book. You know, the average Muslim, mashallah, tabarakallah, if he leads the salah, 20 people behind him correct him before he makes a mistake. You know those people that are always excited? They want to show that they memorized the Quran also. He's just waiting. Ya Rab, he's making dua that the imam makes a mistake so he can correct him. Ya Sheikh, give the imam a second to breathe, Allah yahdi. Even if the imam made a mistake, give him a second. When he sees that he didn't realize the mistake, then you can interfere, barakallah fi. Some people, 20 people reply. One of them is standing in the last row near the bathroom. He's screaming for the imam to hear him in the front. But the guy behind him can hear him, Ya Sheikh, and he can tell him. But some people have a misconception about why do you have to correct the imam. وَتَفْتَحَ لَلْإِمَامِ إِذُ أَخْطَأَ عَلَى الْعُمُومِ. It's a miracle. The Quran is a miracle. وَلَكِنْ لَمَّا كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبُ وَلَكِنْ لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ وَأَلْقَى السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. But that miracle of the Quran is not for everybody. No. It is only for a person who has a heart and he listens attentively and he bears witness to this truth. أَمَّا الْمُعْرِضُ. As for the one who turns away, فَسَيَقُولُ كَمَا قَالَ مَنْ سَبَقَهُ هَذَا أَسَاطِيرُ الْأَوَّلِينَ. He will say like those who preceded him, these are only the fairy tales of the people of the past. Wallahi, this is all true. Wallahi, it is true. الْحَاصِلُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَخَاتَمُ النَّبِيِّينَ خَتَمَ اللَّهُ بِهِ النُّبُوَّةَ وَالرِّسَالَةَ أَيْضًا. So the bottom line is that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah and the seal of all prophets. Allah sealed all prophethood and messengership with him. لِأَنَّهُ إِذَا انْتَفَتِ النُّبُوَّةِ وَهِيَ أَعْمِنَ الرِّسَالَةِ انْتَفَتَ الرِّسَالَةِ أَخَصْ. If prophethood ended, then by default, messengership ended as well. Because prophethood is more encompassing than messengership. You understand? Meaning every messenger is a prophet, but not every prophet is a messenger. So for you to be a messenger, you have to be a prophet first. If the prophet is Khatamun Nabi in the seal of all prophet, then obviously there will be no more messenger, because you cannot be a messenger unless you're a prophet. All right? I hope you're on the same page. By the way, inshallah, this time, at the end of the session, we will have a Q&A. And so if you have any questions, just hold your horses until we get there. بِإِذْنِ عز وجل. Hey, لِأَنَّ انْتِفَاءَ الْعَامِ يَسْتَلْزِمُ انْتِفَاءَ الْخَاصِ. Because when you negate the more general thing, you're automatically negating that which is more specific. فَرَسُولُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ هُوَ خَاتَمُ النَّبِيِّينَ. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the seal of all prophets. قَوْلُهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ تَسْلِيمًا مَزِيدًا. طيب. As for the statement, الشرح معنى صلى الله عليه أحسن ما قيل فيه ما قاله أبو العالية رحمه الله قال صلاة الله على رسوله ثناؤه عليه في الملأ الأعلى. As for the statement صلى الله عليه, because you know a lot of the non Arabs, they really get confused with the terminology. They say أخي صلاة. صلاة is when we pray. تمام. How can Allah pray on the Prophet if you go by verbatim, if you go face value? Sallallahu alayhi, it almost seems for the one who doesn't understand that Allah is praying upon the Prophet, because salah means salah, it's a prayer. But the actual term salah has multiple meanings. So it depending on the context, it could be salah, the ritual prayer, it could be salah, it could be dua, It could be salah from silah, a connection, and it could be praise. That's why the best definition was given by Abu Ali, Salatullah ala Rasul, meaning when Allah Azza wa Jal praises him in the most exalted assembly, which is the assembly of the angels, al-Mala' al-A'la. So when Allah mentions the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam among the most exalted assembly, that is the definition of as-salatu alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَأَمَّا مَنْ فَسَّرَ صَلَاتُ الْعَلَيْهِ بِالرَّحْمَةِ فَقَوْلُ دَعِيفٍ. As for the people who say that salah of Allah upon the Prophet means mercy, then this is a weak opinion. لِأَنَّ الرَّحْمَةَ تَكُونُ لِكُلِّ أَحَدٍ. Because mercy is for everyone. وَلِهَذَا أَجْمَعَ الْعُلَمَاءَ عَلَى أَنَّكَ يَجُوزُ أَن تَقُولُ فُلَانَ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ. That's why the scholars have agreed unanimously that it is permissible for you to say such and such person, may Allah have mercy on him. وَاخْتَلَفُوا هَلْ يَجُوزُ أَن تَقُولُ فُلَانَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. They differ. Can you, however, say this person, may Allah have salah upon him? وَهَذَا يَدُلُّ عَلَى أَنَّ الصَّلَاةَ غَيْرِ الرَّحْمَةِ. This is an indication that salah and rahmah are not synonymous, and they're not the same. وأيضا فقد قال الله تعالى أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة. سورة البقرة آية 57 الله says verily those shall have the salawat from their Lord and mercy. والعطف يقتضي المغايرة. The fact that there's a conjunction, this means there's a variation. إذا فالصلاة أقص من الرحمة. So salah is more specific than mercy. فالصلاة على فالصلاة الله على رسوله ثناؤه عليه بالملائكة الأعلى. So then we say then the salah of Allah upon His Messenger is His praise for Him in the closest and most honorable assembly to Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. وكذلك قوله وعلى آله وآله هنا أتباعي على دينه. Similarly, the statement upon His آل. آل here means all of those who follow His religion. هذا إذا ذكرت الآل وحدها أو مع الصحب. So when it's mentioned independently or in the context of companionship, فإنها تكون بمعنى أتباعي على دينه منذ بعثة إلى يوم القيامة. This means it is referring to all of his followers from the upon his religion from the day he was sent forth until the day of resurrection. From the day of his advent until the day of resurrection. Anyone who follows his religion is from the al of Muhammad. When you say salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, meaning atba' Muhammad, meaning the followers of Muhammad. ويدل على أن الآل بمعنى الأتباع على الدين قوله تعالى في آل فرعون. And an evidence for that, that آل means followers, the statement of Allah regarding the people of فرعون. النار يعرضون عليها غدوا وعشية. The fire, they will be presented to it in the morning and in the evening. They will be exposed in the morning and in the evening. ويوم تقوم الساعة أدخلوا آل فرعون أشد العذاب. And when the hour is established, then admit the people of Fir'aun into the severest torment. Then admit the people of Fir'aun into the severest torment. So they use al to refer to ay atba'i ala dini, meaning the followers of his religion and not his family members per se. أما إذا قرنت بالأتباع فقيل آله وأتباعه فالآل هم المؤمنون من آل البيت. However, if in the same sentence you have اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آله وأتباعه, if you mention أتباع on your own, then آل becomes in reference to the believers of his household. أي بيت الرسول عليه السلام, meaning the family of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Now the irony in this is that the Shia, they, of course, you know, they have their claim that they Al Bayt wa mash arif ish, they have all these funny turbans and all these lies that they lie. These liars, they make the family of the Prophet restricted to Ali and Fatima and then their children. Even though the household of the Prophet includes Aisha, whom they say is an evil woman, may Allah curse them until Yawm al-Qiyamah, and whom they accuse her of evil things that I don't even want to mention. They curse Abu Bakr, who's the father of Aisha and the best friend of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and his companion in the cave, صاحبه في الغار. And they curse Umar al-Faruq, the one whom Allah azza wa jal made a distinction between truth and falsehood. And they curse Uthman, يا Ya Sheikh, يعني, how evil can you be of a people? How can you claim to be a Muslim and hate the wife of the Messenger of Allah, whom he loved, and hate his best, the first three khulafa? What Islam are you even talking about? And then they come on TV and they beat themselves. And, ya Sheikh, uqsum billah, is this? Wallah shayateen. Ya brother Aslam, Allah yarda alayk, keep your camera off, ya Sheikh. Your screen sharing, habibi. Shayateen, ya jama'ah, these are from the shayateen of ins and jinn. Uqsum billah, how can this be? And they want us to make people today, du'at, they want to reconcile and make peace with the Shia. What peace and which world are you living in? Do you really think there's any hope with these people? From the time of Ali until now, they have done nothing but harm the Muslims and tarnish our image and make us look like the worst people on earth. Ya Sheikh, their celebrations on Ashura alone will make anyone leave religion. If you see them, and they do this in the UK and in the US, they want to go on the streets and they beat themselves with the knives and cut their heads with swords and they bleed almost to death. Ish al-ghaba hada, what kind of stupidity is this? They have the nerve to come and say, we love the Ahlul Bayt and we are Ahlul Bayt. Ayy Ahlul Bayt, Ahlul Bayt bura'a minkum, wallah al-azim. Wallah, Ahlul Bayt are innocent of these maniacs. وشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله لم يذكر الأتباع هنا. شيخ الإسلام didn't mention the followers. قال آلي وصحبي فنقول آل هم أتباع على دينه. So what is referred by آل in this one is the followers upon his religion. وصحبه كل من اجتمع بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مؤمنا به ومات على ذلك. As for the definition of a companion, it's anybody who met the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, believed in him and died upon that. He met the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He believed in him and he died upon that. Why? Because someone might apostate. Someone might apostate. Someone might have not met the Prophet ﷺ. We cannot call him a companion. They have to have met. Even if he's blind, he doesn't have to have seen him. Huh? Like Ibn Maktoum, he was blind. If he met the Prophet ﷺ and he died upon Islam, he's a Sahabi. And if he's a Sahabi, he's been promised Jannah. So don't bother and waste your time talking ill about them. The people that are always trying to fetch for what happened between Muawiyah and Ali and Uthman and Yazid, and they jump here and jump there and trying to look for individual mistakes and try to frame them, they have already received the endorsement of Allah. Radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhum. Allah's peace with them and you are peace with them. That's why when someone came to Imam Malik saw someone cursing one of the Sahaba. He said, do you know that Allah's peace with them? Do you know the ayah? He said, yeah. He said, did it reach you that after Allah is pleased with them, he became angry with them? Did you have any, do you have any such data? Then don't speak. The Prophet ﷺ said, لَا تَسُبُّ أَصْحَابِي. Don't verbally abuse my companions. So I advise you, be careful of those people that are trying to highlight mistakes of the Sahaba, because we already know they made mistakes. But it is not my business and yours to go looking into theirs, because they have a relationship with Allah, which we don't have. Worry about yourself. Worry about yourself. The Sahaba, على الرأس والعين, on our head, on our eye, wallah, nothing but love and veneration and appreciation for people that sacrificed so much for the deen to reach us today. You want to criticize them? You got a problem. Hey. طيب. نعم. وعطف الصحب هنا على الآل من باب عطف القاس على العام لأن الصحب أقص من مطلق الأتباع. طيب, this is another grammatical approach to things, and we will skip it inshallah. طيب, قوله وسلم تسليما مزيدا. سلم فيه السلام من الآفات وهي الصلاة وفي الصلاة حصول الخيرات. سلم meaning he like secured. It's a form of security and peace, meaning being at peace from all different matters. So it is being at peace from any type of difficulty, any type of hardship. And in the context of salah, it is the attainment of the various kinds of good. Any type of good that you want to attain, then that's that. فجمع المؤلف في هذه الصيغة بين سؤال الله تعالى أن يحقق لنبيه الخيرات وأخصها الثناء عليه في الملأ الأعلى. So the author in this form that he used, he was able to bring a relation that Allah Azza wa Jal grants his prophet all types of good, and the most specific of which to praise him and mention him among the exalted assembly, and also to remove any kind of difficulty and hardship from him and from his followers. والجملة في قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم خبرية لفظا طيب. We will, bottom line, it's a form of dua, even though it's the tense in which it's used is of a particular kind. The bottom line is that it remains to be a dua. طيب. وقوله مزيدا. As for the statement مزيدا, مزيدا يعني بمعنى زائدا أو زيادة. It's abundance. It has to do with abundance, something additional. والمراد تسليما زائدا على الصلاة. What is intended is that he gets peace in addition to the salah. فَيَكُونُ دُعَاءً آخَرًا بِالسَّلَامِ بَعْدَ الصَّلَاةِ. So it will be another dua of security and peace after the exaltation among the close angels. وَالرَّسُولُ عِنْدَ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ مَنْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْهِ بِشَرْعٍ وَأُمِرَ بِتَبْلِيغِ. Very important definition. The meaning of a messenger according to the people of knowledge is he who has been given a specific sharia, a particular sharia, and he was ordered to convey it to the people. He was ordered to propagate. So first you have to have a legislative law, and then you have to convey it to the people. Now, وَقَدْ نُبِّئَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِإِقْرَى. The Prophet ﷺ became a prophet with the word Iqra. When Jibreel came to say Iqra, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, khalaqa al-insana min 'alaq, Iqra wa rabbuka al-akram, until the end of the ayah. Wa ursila bil mudaththir. So he was made a prophet with the ayah Iqra, and then he was made a messenger, he was made a messenger bi wa ursila bil mudaththir. Fa bi qawli ta'ala اقرا بسم ربك الذي خلق الى قولي على من يسمع يا من جن ربي ان وكان نبيا بقوله يا ايها المدثر قم فانذر. So when Allah Azza wa Jal revealed, mudathir is the one who's covered up in garments, the one who's enveloped in garments, when Allah said to him arise and warn. So the Prophet ﷺ became a prophet with the اقرأ until علم الانسان ما لم يعلم. And then he became a messenger. He was sent now to the people when Allah Azza wa Jal revealed, Ya ayyuhal muddathir, kum fa'andhir, until the end of the ayat. Qawlu. Amma ba'd. Aha. Again. Qawlu. Amma ba'd. Fahada i'tiqadu al-firqati al-najiyati al-mansurati ila qiyam al-sa'ati ahl-us-sunnah wal-jamaa'ah. Wallahi, this. Yani the statement makes my heart tremble, and it brings joy to the heart, because now we're going to get into the real deal as to what follows. Hada, meaning this, what you are about to read, is the i'tiqad, is the belief, the creed of the saved and aided sect until the last hour, until the establishment of the hour, Ahl-us-Sunnah wal-Jamaa'ah, the people of Sunnah and Jama'ah. Of course, we will mention later that a lot of people hijack this term Ahl-us-Sunnah wal-Jamaa'ah, but the original and authentic one is the one that is obviously being used by us. And of course, everybody says us, but we have the understanding of the Salaf to support us, and those other innovators, they surely don't. طيب, we'll skip some of the grammar. All of this is grammar. Here he elaborates on the term هذا اعتقاد and why it was used. Again, I don't think this is going to add any value, so I'm going to be okay. Now we're going to explain اعتقاد. اعتقاد افتعال من العقد أو العقد وهو الرد والشد. So the term i'tiqad is actually derived from a knot. A knot is that which you tie and you strengthen the tie. Right? You tie it up and then you have a knot. You know, that's why you have a knot, in order to make it firm. طيب. Here we go. Hey. وهذا من حيث التصريف اللغوي. وأما في الإصلاح عندهم فهو حكم الذهن الجازم. The Sheikh said this is just a linguistic approach to things. It's, you know, something that is binding and something that is tying. But with the people of terminology, then the حكم هو حكم الذهن الجازم. It's whatever you firmly and feel determined about. Anything that you believe and have a determination about in your heart is al-i'tiqad. You call i'tiqadtu kada, yani jazamtu bihi fi qalbi. If you say, I believe so, I have this i'tiqad, meaning I have this firm, 100% guarantee in my heart. فَهُوَ حُكْمُ الذِّهِنْ الْجَازِمْ فَإِنْ طَابَقَ الْوَاقِعْ فَصَحِيحْ وَإِنْ خَالَفَ الْوَاقِعْ فَفَاسِدْ. Be careful, because if that firm belief you have is in agreement with the truth, then no problem, it's correct. But if it opposes the reality, then it is corrupt. فَاعْتِقَادُنَا أَنَّ اللَّهَ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ صَحِيحٌ. Our i'tiqad that Allah is one and unique in His oneness is correct. وَاعْتِقَادُ النَّصَارَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ ثَالِثُ ثَلَاثَ بَاطِلٌ. As for the belief of the Christian that Allah is one third of the triune God is false. لِأَنَّهُ مُقَارِفٌ لِلْوَاقَعِ, because it opposes the reality. وجه ارتباط المعنى اللغوي الظاهر بالمعنى ووجه ارتباطه بالمعنى اللغوي ظاهر, لأن هذا الذي حكم في قلبي على شيء حكم في قلبي على شيء ما كأنه عقده عليه وشده عليه بحيث لا يتفلت منه. Why is there a relation between the linguistic and the legislative meaning? Why do we use this term? Because once a person has a firm belief in something, it's almost like he believes in it, then he ties a knot, a very strong one, around it. And so that's why it's called i'tiqad, from aqad, uqda, and ya'qid, and so on, and so forth. وَالْفِرْقَ بِكَسْرِ الْفَاءِ. وَالْفِرْقَ بِكَسْرِ الْفَاءِ بِمَعْنَ الطَّائِفَةِ. فِرْقَ meaning a group, with the كَسْرَ on the فَاءِ. قَالَ تَعَالَى فَلَوْلَا نَفَرَ مِنْ كُلِّ فِرْقَةٍ مِنْهُمْ طَائِفَةٍ. مِنْ كُلِّ فِرْقَةٍ مِنْهُمْ طَائِفَةٍ. So Allah Azza wa Jal said, in regards to this particular meaning, for there should separate from every division of them a group. وَأَمَّا الْفُرْقَ بِالضَّمْ فَهِيَ مَأْخُوذَ مِفْتِرَاقٍ. As for the word فُرْقَ, with the Dhamma on the fa, this comes from the division. So that's why the Arabic language is so, so particular. So it's the same word. If you don't have the tashkeel, then you may get confused. Is it firqa or furqa? Firqa is a group, a denomination, a sect. Furqa is division. It's a form of division. So that, subhanAllah, the word itself can have opposite meanings depending on the diacritical signs that come on the word. That's why it's important to understand the Arabic language. And that's why I've said many times, people give da'wah who don't have an Arabic background, they struggle because they don't have a reference to depend on. If the translator misses something out, then everybody gets lost in the process. وَالنَّاجِيَةُ اسْمٌ اسْمُ فَاعِلٍ مِنْ نَجَى إِذَا سَلِيمَ نَاجِيَةٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا مِنَ الْبِدَعِ سَلِيمَةٌ مِنْهَا وَنَاجِيَةٌ فِي الْآخِرِ مِنَ النَّارِ. Najiya meaning save is when you've been saved from something. So this group is saved in this dunya from innovations, and it is saved in the life to come from the hellfire. We seek refuge with Allah from the hellfire. Hey. وجه ذلك أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال وستفترق هذه الأمة على 73 فرقة. And the reason we say this is because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this ummah shall divide into 73 sects. كلها في النار إلا واحدة. All of them will be in the hellfire except one. قَالُوا مَنْ هِيَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ They said, which one is it, O Messenger of Allah? قَالَ مَنْ كَانَ عَلَى مِثْلِ مَا أَنَا عَلَيْهِ وَأَصْحَابِهِ He said, whoever is upon what I am and my companions. And this we can elaborate on for days. And that's why, my brothers and sisters, we call to the way of our righteous predecessors. Because you can see that the Ummah will divide. Today you have the modernists and this and that, all types of groups called the Tablighi Jama'at and Ikhwan al-Muslimin and Mush'arif Ish and Sufis and everybody's calling you to them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, those among them who are still Muslims, they will divide. The only ones who will be saved are the ones who are upon what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was upon and its companions. So you ask Tablighi Jama'at. Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam go on Khuruj for 3 days and 40 days and 4 months and, you know, and have a read from the book Tablighi Nisab, or I don't know what they call it, Fada'il Sabaqat, books that are full of innovations and full of shirk and full of fabricated narrations that can never be attributed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Did the Sahaba do this? No, he sent Mu'ad ibn Jabal and he sent the Sahaba and Hudayfa. He sent those who had knowledge, sent only one to the people of Yemen, say, go to them, tell them that there's La ilaha illallah. If they obey you, then tell them that Allah made salah obligatory on them 5 times in the day, night and the day. The first thing he told them to call the people to was Tawheed. Any Muslim, any group, any denomination, anybody who doesn't begin his da'wah with Tawheed is calling you to falsehood. Those people that all day they want to soften your heart and give you admonishments and reminders, and they never mention Tawheed and they never warn against shirk and they never warn against innovation, are doing a disservice to this Ummah. And they're not following the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam nor his companions. Ala kulli hal, we will stop here inshallah, and I will open the floor for questions. Mark where we stopped. We are at the end of page 50 inshallah ta'ala. Let me see what we have in the chat. No problem, whoever made a mistake and posted your screen by mistake, no problem, it happens. Jazakumullah khair. Just be careful in the future, Allah yarda alaykum. Because brothers and sisters, we are recording this and then we are uploading it. So whenever there's any interference, it makes our job so much more difficult to edit. And it's like the work which is supposed to take 5 minutes becomes actually 5 hours of my family editing and changing and cutting and pasting and removing and all before we upload, and we have to render it after it's all said and done. But yani, let's avoid this as much as possible. No problem. My classmate, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My classmate got a scholarship to India immediately after our schooling. After completing his course, he has become a alim in Qadiani. I have given him da'wah and no response as of now. Is it allowed for us to support him financially if he's having financial difficulties? Do classmates usually get financial help from their classmates? From their friends? I don't know about that. I would say if there's hope in bringing him back to the truth, yes. If there's no hope, then no. If there's hope, you'll be able to bring him back to the truth, then yes. If there's no hope, then no. Because I'm afraid if you support him and you help him, you are actually giving him a platform and the ability to further propagate. He's a alim, meaning he's going to do da'wah. You're actually helping him in destroying the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ. If there's no hope in him coming back, no, do not be involved in this. If Allah has it meant for him to be helped, Allah Azza wa Jal will help him through other means. Don't be involved in it directly. Any other questions? Kind of explain one more time what you mentioned about Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He heard the scribbling of pen. None reached that level, as you mentioned, to make us sure what understood is correct. Yes, we know that he made it so high in the during Al-Isra and Mi'raj, to the point that he was able to hear the scribbling of the angels that write down what Allah Azza wa Jal decrees. He heard the scratching of the pen on the paper. And this is in the hadith, the long hadith of Isra and Mi'raj. I hear a Shia friend of mine saying, Allahumma salli Allah alayhi salam for Ali. Is this okay? Of course not. Yeah, Shaykh, if this was the only problem, it would be a piece of cake. The Shia call on Ali besides Allah. Wallah al-Azim. And we even heard them once in Hajj. Wallahi, we were on Hajj with the new Muslims from the Philippines. We were sitting in our tent and we heard the people in the next tent. They say, Ya Hussein, Ya Hassan, Ya Madriyesh, Ya Hussein, Ya Ali. Ya. And on Hajj, they were calling on other than Allah. On Hajj. Alayhi salam is given to the prophets. You know why they say this? Because they believe that their 12 imams are better than the prophets. The Shia, the Ithna Ashariya, the 12 imams, believers, they believe that their imams, they were born from the thighs of their mothers because of how pure they are. And they believe that they manage this world with Allah, and they believe that they are better than the prophets. So of course he's going to say about Ali alayhi salam, because to him Ali is better than the Messenger of Allah. In fact, they believe that Jibreel made a mistake. Instead of going to Ali, he went to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ash'ariya, we will come. The name Ash'ariya is in reference to the Imam Al-Ash'ari, who actually, يعني, according to, we will discuss him when the time comes. A major segment of the book will be about the Ash'ari and their belief and their refutations. If you ask me questions about what will come later in the book, then it will defeat the purpose of going over the book. So please allow me to leave that to next time, inshallah. Time is up. Okay, how can we make sure that we are among Al-Firqa Najiyah? 1 second, please. How do you make sure that you're from the Firqa Najiyah? You follow the Quran and the Sunnah according to the understanding of the righteous predecessors. And so that's what we follow. So if you watch myself, Brother Muhammad Tim Humble, Abdurrahman Hassan, and those brothers, inshallah ta'ala, these are the English mediators that you have, intermediaries between you and the scholars, inshallah. We are calling to the same way. We're calling to the way of the righteous predecessors. And once you follow that, then inshallah you can guarantee to be among those. I got a question through WhatsApp. I don't know how. How do I keep intention purely for the sake of Allah? Whenever I want to fast, my mind thinks of weight loss. So my intention to fast is not purely for Allah. How can I avoid this minor shirk? By not letting the shaitan play games with you. Don't let the shaitan play games with you. Alas, you want to fast for the sake of Allah, end of story. You lose weight, alhamdulillah, no problem in having that intention there. It's a byproduct. But you have to resist. It's a matter of resistance and not giving in. The shaitan's going to keep whispering to you. Ignore. Alas, you did it for the sake of Allah. Case closed. Next. Is watching videos with women without proper hijab not allowed? I know it's wrong, but I want to gain knowledge. I don't know if you're a sister watching another sister, but subhanAllah, I just posted a lecture on my YouTube channel titled The Male is Unlike the Female. So please watch the lecture. It's on my YouTube channel, One Way to Paradise, titled The Male is Unlike the Female. So I think it's Sister Myla. The answer to your question is there comprehensively. Comprehensively, inshallah. If you still have a question afterwards, then we can address it next week. But I think the lecture is straightforward about that very question, because the whole lecture is actually to answer that question. Hey. Na'am, barakallahu feekum. Tayyib, any other questions? If no question comes in within a few seconds, then we will call it a day and wrap up, inshallah. I know it's coming, it's almost Maghrib here, also maybe 20 minutes away from Maghrib. Many of you have preparations. I don't want to hold you back. Tayyib, it looks like that's it. Jazakumullah khair. Allah bless you all. And I look forward to seeing you next week, inshallah. Try to have a bigger number. Wallahi, the Ummah needs this. By the way, if 3 people attend, or 1 people attend, or 100 people attend, there's no... I don't get anything. I'm not trying to join a contest of the most followers, nor do I make any money from this. But I want the benefit to be maximized. If we are having this activity, then more people should attend. So feel free to invite others, because from our group of 125, I don't know how many actually attended, but you know, there's only 36 people right now. So maybe those who are not active should be removed and replaced with those who are more interested. I actually rejected many people that asked me to join. I told them, I'm sorry, the group is full. And I would have added them. Hisham, I already answered that question, Habibi. Again, what's that? I did watch it. Well, if you're a woman, for the issue of the woman, if you're a woman watching another woman, then there's no harm. But who is the shaykha يعني, that is so important that you want to learn from her and not learn from the brothers? I don't know of any alima at a real high level that is going to display her not wearing proper hijab at the same time she's so reliable. If you have one, alhamdulillah, there's no harm. A woman may watch another woman, no issue. Even if she's a non-Muslim, you may watch her. You don't have to lower your gaze, no issue. But make sure that you're listening to the right sources. I already made a lecture about what happens to the soul after one dies. It's titled, there's one titled 6 feet under, all alone. Watch my lecture on YouTube, yeah, Sarah. Titled 6 feet under, 6 feet under, all alone. And there's another one that's called the difficult questions? There's another one that speaks about the questions that you will be asked in the grave. Ala kulli hal, that lecture addresses inshallah. What is the greater Israel means that one Mawlana is talking about? I don't know. But if you're talking about, what's his name? Imran Hussein, then I swear by Allah he's not your Mawlana. Imran Hussein is a deviant, misguided individual that speaks. He's in his own world. He doesn't even share his views with anyone else except himself and his followers. And any interpretation he has about the Dajjal and all this stuff is all bogus. If you're referring to Imran Hussein, remove the word Mawlana, sister, you may not learn from Imran Hussein. This guy has fault. He does not take anything face value. Nothing to him is as it is. Everything means something different. The religion gets lost in the process with people like this. We got signed out. Does he currently sign in on another device? Are you still there? Is it still on? Interesting. Okay. Yeah, brother, there's no contradiction. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is when he was here, when he was with them. He told them about things in the future and in the past, but when he was taken in the ascension, Allah made him see things in the present, in that present form then. He saw Isa, he saw Musa, he saw different people, even though the Prophet ﷺ already told us that Musa had died. Then Allah saw Musa again. So whatever Allah Azza wa Jal allowed the Prophet ﷺ to see in the Isra is specific to the occasion of the Isra. And there's no contradiction between them. There's no, and we know that until now, even though the Allah Azza wa Jal, what is the ayah in the Quran? There's an ayah in the Quran. وَعِنْدَهُ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ. Who remembers the ayah? يَمْحُو اللَّهُ مَا يَشَاءُ وَيُثَبِّتُ. Allah Azza wa Jal erases whatever He wills or He confirms. So Allah told us in the Quran that things, your dua, ya akhi, changes the qadr. Your dua changes the qadr. So there's no contradiction between them. The matter of qadr is a very dynamic one, and there's no contradiction between them, inshallah. Don't try to create an issue from a non-issue, then you will have an issue. The passing grade, yeah, there you go. That was the other lecture, the passing grade. Yeah, Muhammad, yalla, but we're running late. That's the last question by Brother Muhammad. Ask a question apart from today's lesson. The last question, because we're running out of time. Allah bless you. I hope you have it ready. All right. Can a woman lead being imam of prayer like the men? Can you write when I post my lecture about the male is unlike the female? I get all the questions about it. A woman may never lead. You mean if she's leading, is it permissible to be an imam for women? Yes, a woman may lead other women in salah, but she doesn't stand in front of them. She stands in the middle. If a woman leads other women in salah, she may do so. She stands in the middle and they stand to her right and to her left. But a woman may never lead men in salah. So I understand the question. I hope I've answered it. Jazakumullah khair. Take care of yourselves. See you next week. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.